Okay, well, first of all, thank you very much to all of you for coming here and for waiting for these first few minutes when we were just testing the video to make sure it would work. Because the idea of having a practical demonstration, well, it always brings with it some kind of practical complications. So, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers of INCIBE for inviting us here to talk about the problems with the SCADA, the fourth generation SCADA systems. And then I would just like to talk a little bit in greater detail. I am Jesús Friginal. I'm in charge of projects and research in the SCASI cybersecurity company in Spain, and we take care and deal with these kinds of problems in the industrial field as well. Miquel, who is sat next to me here on my right, as Asier said, is completing his PhD in the UPV and is a specialist in these kinds of problems, the injection of errors in the control of these kind of systems and wireless networks. So to start then, I would like to talk a little bit about the presentation. Basically, we will have an introduction of what SCADA systems are, what ICS are, the critical systems, and then we will talk about the evolution or the development of these kinds of systems over history. And I'm talking here today about the fourth generation SCADA systems, to be precise. Then we will begin to approach the pen testing methodology in general terms for these kinds of systems. And lastly, the best part, as we could say, which will be up to Miquel, he is going to give you a presentation of a specific attack against a protocol, and this will give some meaning to this setup that you can see at the front, all this equipment we've got with us, but you'll hear about that later on. So without going on for too long, I would like to start the presentation with this question. What is a critical or infrastructure or critical system? If we go to the philosophical side of things, what's critical and what is not critical, well, we could spend hours talking about that, because for one person it may be critical, and for another person it may not be. And for some people, what's really critical, for example, for my mum, what would be terrible for my mum would be if WhatsApp collapsed or crashed. I mean, for me, no, because I don't have WhatsApp. So the idea of something being critical or not depends on our personal perspective. And in order to talk about this in perhaps more official terms, we will talk of the critical definition according to the law. Critical infrastructures, as they are defined in the PIC law, which is 8/2011, this talks about the fact that a critical infrastructure is a set of resources and services, or even technologies, which, if they were to suffer an attack, would cause a great impact on physical and economic safety of the citizens living in that society, and could affect the good functioning of the national government. So with this, we are being a bit more specific in our definition of critical from the point of view of society, of what affects a government of a state. Obviously, if the person who, well, thank you. With this, now we can see what we're talking about. If we talk about critical systems, we're talking about an underground network, infrastructures such as a dam, electricity networks, and such like. And to be a little more specific, I'm going to talk about two things here. What, according to the law, are the different kinds of critical infrastructures? And secondly, well, we'll see the color coding. I will explain the colors and what they're all about. So according to the National Plan for Protection of Critical Infrastructures, we divide, or we could consider 12 different strategic sectors, going from power stations and energy networks, IT technologies, communication technology. I'm reading this through because I don't know it off by memory. The financial and tax system. So here we're talking about banking. Obviously, a crash in the banking system would collapse the whole economy of a country. So you have to think about that kind of thing to understand what these kind of critical infrastructures are. The health sector, obviously, space, research facilities, food, water, this is very, very important, transport, everything related to ports, airports, railway, roads, motorways. You can get an idea, I imagine. The nuclear industry, obviously, as well, the chemical industry, and the administration, the services provided by the state. And now I'm going to talk about the color code, the CNPIC, which is the National Center for the Protection of Critical Infrastructures, draws up different safety plans for the operators in each of these infrastructures. And the colors refer to the plans which have already been approved, those which are underway and which will come in the future. So the plans which have already been approved, we have the one for power stations, energy networks, finance and tax system, the banking sector, the health sector, and also the nuclear sector. Those are the ones that have already been approved. And the ones that have very recently been approved, water, transport, and chemical industry, or the chemistry industry. And then, on the other hand, we have space and information technologies, which are coming soon, and the other ones, sorry, those are the ones that will be finished shortly in the future. So the operators have to provide, well, these plans have to provide rules for the operators so that they know how to deal with their critical infrastructures, they can have everything up to date, and they can take it into account. And with this, you can get an idea of where the audits would be focusing to make sure that the operators are complying with the law in these areas. If you have any questions or anything's not clear, please make sure you do interrupt me. I would like this to be an interactive session. So now we'll talk about the other part of this subject, which are the SCADA systems. So on the one hand, we've talked about critical infrastructures and what SCADA got to do with critical infrastructures. Well, I'll give you a clue. The acronym represents supervision, control, and acquisition of data. And so this gives us an idea of what is hiding behind these letters for those of you who are not familiar with these terms. So in reality, this clue, well, it's a little perhaps not quite, not very specific, because do we have here a system of SCADA? Well, it could be, but we are used to talking about automatic software hardware systems which are linked to industrial use. So that's an important aspect of SCADA systems. And indeed, we could use pictures here. Here what we're looking at is a control panel from a nuclear reactor. And what we can see here above all is the HMI, the human-machine interface, where the operator follows the whole operation, the sensors, the PLCs, and that kind of thing. And we'll talk a little further about that later on. But this is to give a few names to the things that we see. Other examples could be like this one. This is a little bit more elaborate. We have the flight control center for the space station, the International Space Station, and this is also a SCADA system because they are monitoring, supervising systems in real time. They are taking decisions. There is feedback between what's being measured and the decisions that are taken, and that's really what is behind the definition of a SCADA system. And to tie this all down, I would just like to mention a few last things, a few brushstrokes about the structure of a SCADA system. Basically, we are talking about systems which are decomposed in geographic terms. So in one place we may have the control center, somewhere else we will have the communications, and in other places we will have the final communication with all of this technology using sensors, actuators, and such like. And if you can't see this very clearly, then on the left of the screen, what we have is a division of concepts. So we have in one place we have the control center, then we have the communication, and in a third location we have the components which actually operate in the field. And on the right, what you can see is just an example of a PLC. This could be Siemens, it could be, well, any other brand. We're not going to go into that kind of detail of the differences between brands in this field of technology, but I just want you to understand that in a SCADA system, what you basically have is this division of systems. So on the one hand, we have the control, on the other hand, the communication system, and on the other hand, or thirdly, the final components. So I repeated that, and I want to highlight that because we're going to see how this has developed over time. We're going to see the different kinds of SCADA systems over time and what criteria we can use to classify them. Basically, the main criteria that we could take into account when it comes to clarifying the progress of the SCADA systems could talk about geographical distribution, like I mentioned before. So right now we could have a classification of SCADA systems from the first generation to right through to the fourth generation. Indeed, in the first generation, if we look quite a long way back, quite a few years back, we are talking about monolithic systems. So I'm sure you all have an idea of what that is, but just to give you a couple of clues, we'd be talking about the kind of system which bring together all of the functions we've seen, and that division of systems that we've seen before, it would have been considered as a single block. So we would have the control, the communication interface, the sensors, all within one single system. Of course, this worked quite well at the start when we didn't have big industrial systems. We were limited to industrial plants where management or control was done within one single block, and it worked very well. And indeed, there are many SCADA systems at the moment in many companies that continue using that approach. But if we go to a higher level of complexity, for example, instead of having right now a single base, we would have several replicated bases. So this would be a distributed system. So in other words, the control could still be done in a central station, but now we have different modules which operate between themselves in order to give an overall service. So in one place we may have sensors that perform one purpose, they measure one particular activity, and somewhere else we will have others which are in charge of something completely different. And to a certain degree, we have a diversification of the activities within the SCADA system. I think this is quite intuitive, the next step. So if we go from distributed systems, which are apparently together, so we have the central node, the control center, where we have the decision taking in a centralized way, but the distribution of those components will become more and more dispersed in geographical terms. And this brings us to the third generation systems. So the geographical distribution is much greater. So we could be talking about a system that covers a country, systems for distributing and managing the electricity supply, for example. So we have one plant maybe on the mouth of the Ebro River, but the control of that supply may be 300 kilometers or 200 kilometers away. So as we need to control all of these systems, it becomes necessary to include new systems for the control of those infrastructures. And these systems obviously need a network. And that's when we're going to have problems, because the systems are going to be separate, and the only connection that exists between them are network cables, satellite systems. So we're talking about systems which are not in the location itself. They are remote to a certain degree. And right now, a lot of the systems would be within this third generation group. And lastly, then, I shall talk about the fourth generation system, which gradually, over time, will become more and more important. Indeed, 4G, the fourth generation, basically adds to the third generation, And what it adds is the possibility of using Internet of Things. And I'm sure that this sounds familiar to you. You hear about it on the radio, you might read about it in the press, and there are blogs where they start to talk about this kind of thing. So what's the challenge? The challenge is all about how to connect systems, you know, on the ground, so actuators and sensors, with more and more capacity to communicate and to process and to help in the taking of decisions. But at the same time, they have to be transparent in their environment, and we have to have self-management. So in other words, we're talking about networks which can be configured to manage errors. And the challenge lies with the fact that these networks are dispersed, distributed throughout the SCADA system, and some of them are working in a wireless way. And this is where we have the greatest challenge. So to include security in these areas, well, until now, they haven't been considered critical systems. But as we include them within a critical infrastructure, then we have to also deal with those needs. And this is what we've seen with the PIC law. The legislator has stressed the fact that within the SCADA system, this has to be protected. And so how can we organize all of this within the security of the systems? Well, what I'm showing here is a diagram which shows the development of these 3G systems, the third generation systems that we have right now. And here we can see the different phases that I mentioned. First of all, we have the first layer where we have the corporate network for the organization. And here we're not specifically talking about SCADA, even though they may take decisions related to SCADA. But that's not quite or exactly what it is. Then we can see that it's kind of like an onion, you know, it's got different layers. So here we have the DMZ SCADA. So this is a more restricted network where we are going to have access to the system control. If we go down another layer, we could find the direct control, for example, of an industrial plant, with the PLCs, industrial programming and such like. And if you go down to the last layer, what we find is the field network. And here we're just talking about sensors and actuators, which take decisions according to what's being communicated from the higher levels, according to the programming in the PLC. And so they get specific instructions. What do we do in this particular case? For example, we have the control of valves, tubes, fire control, smoke detection. All those kinds of technologies are programmed using the PLCs that we have in the superior level. So with this, you can get a bit of an idea of the kind of structure we may come across. And where does the revolution take place? Well, the revolution is here. 4G affects everything regarding the management of devices which are in this layer of sensors and actuators. This whole deployment of devices. So until now, we had devices controlled by means of cables, and we had CAN technology and all of the different versions of that kind of protocol. And more within TCP/IP, we've seen changes, and we've got interoperability with different technologies, which right now are quite mature. They've reached a level of maturity, and they allow us to manage and include systems such as databases that we didn't have in the past. But on the other hand, they also add all of the vulnerabilities that we did not have until now. So if you think in the past we had a monolithic system, very closed with ad hoc designed architectures. So I have a system and I have to create a design and implementation for something which is very specific and limited to the field of action of a specific network. As we migrate towards these newer systems, then what we have to do is standardize the protocols. So I would highlight the fact that, well, as I've said, there are great vulnerabilities and on these in these technologies, and they can be made the most of. And, well, I mean, this subject could be, you know, a subject we could talk about for many hours. But if we come back to what is of interest to us here today, which are the vulnerabilities and the threats in the new 4G systems that we're going to have with wireless technologies, what we are moving towards is this kind of thing. So I would just like to run through this. So basically, we have sensors that will fit, you know, on the palm of your hand, like the ones we've got here on the table in front of us, perhaps a little bigger in some cases. These are highly interconnected. We're talking about systems with a high degree of interaction and connection between devices. And here what we have is an architecture with a Raspberry, Arduino, we've got GPS, control of an anemometer, and this is what we're talking about when we talk about 4G. And I would like to just focus for a moment on the picture that you have more on the left, this big device. Well, I mean, if you've got a big hand, that would fit in your the palm of your hand. And what we can see there is a sensor designed for the Sensei project, which is an HP project. And I just want to mention a couple of things. It's a project which aims to distribute sensor networks around the planet in order to help in the prediction of natural disasters. And this is good because it allows us in real time to help in predicting tsunamis, for example, earthquakes, mudslides, and all of this can help a great deal with great infrastructures if we have wireless sensors on bridges, for example, in tunnels and such like. So this technology has been designed to this end, you know, because it saves costs, because we don't have to lay so many cables. And also, on the other hand, it allows us to take real-time measurements. For those of you who are curious about this, you can go into the link for HP Sensei. It's a huge project in global terms, and basically, well, here we're talking about a SCADA system at a planet-wide level in order to measure different kinds of incidents, events, which could affect different kinds of infrastructures and, in fact, the safety of people. So I've presented the kind of device that we might come across, but when we talk about the deployment of this, well, how do we do it? Because we've said that we're going to try to save cables, we're going to try to get this to work in a distributed way, and, well, how does this all work? What we find are networks of this kind. They are autonomous wireless networks. Often they are multi-leap systems, and we have different gateways which take the information from the sensors, which are, you know, distributed through the network. And those sensors can work in two ways. They can go from point to point. For example, if it's all around a gateway, then we can send the sensor information to the gateway. And if we have a deployment which is greater than that and we cannot bear the cost of all of these gateways, then what we have is, well, what we will do is we would allow the sensors to work with each other in order to transfer the message in a multiple way. So each sensor would serve as a router in order for the message to be sent from sensor to sensor. It would jump from one to the next. And here, where's the challenge? Well, obviously the challenge is in deploying these networks throughout nature, you know, throughout the countryside. And here we have initiatives that we could talk about, which are based on distributing nodes or sensors. There are many ways of deploying them. And I mean, they could even take them from a plane and kind of throw them off. I mean, you know, Some may not then work, but they throw so many that so many of them would work, would operate. So you would have these intermediary nodes which would carry the message to the gateway. And what you can see at the top is a physical deployment. And this could be done by a technician if a prior study is carried out to tell them where they have to put the sensors. Or even, as I said, they could just, you know, throw them out of a plane. You may think that sounds a bit strange, but that's actually, you know, the way it could be done. And here we're talking about sensors that start to communicate within a field of action. They have a certain degree of coverage according to the kind of sensor that we're talking about. So this could be 5 meters. For example, we might have a certain kind of technology, Bluetooth, por ejemplo, which is low energy consumption, or right through to a Wi-Fi system. That's less often when we talk about a sensor network. But it could be used, it's a possibility. And after this deployment, what the node does is it automatically and independently finds its best neighbors in order to route the communication to the gateway. So we have this logical topology. It gathers the information and takes decisions regarding which is the best router in order to redirect the information. And you can imagine that this logical topology and how it would work from the image that we have at the bottom. And the trend that we are observing is that as Internet of Things becomes more and more a part of everyday life, it's more and more present in these kinds of systems, these SCADA systems. And I would insist that the possibility to have compatibility between the systems is ever greater, because this allows us to do a lot of things. So imagine the huge potential that exists between big data and these kinds of sensors. On the one hand, we are able to gather information in real time, which is very precise and very specific and very diverse also from many different sensors, many different sources. And on the other hand, in the higher levels of the SCADA system, we are able to correlate and analyze the information and take out the statistics and the right conclusions. And so the application, the use of that information is really important for humanity. However, we have a problem, and I would insist that going from an isolated problem to a more open and intercommunicating system, this has an impact, and it means that we are facing more and more threats. So what happens with the threats in these kinds of systems? If we asked a technician who works with these SCADA systems, well, this is really an aberration, because they're going to understand that we are going from an isolated system, which is fully controlled, to a very hard to control system. Like in these two pictures, we are talking about an impregnable bastion where we have full control over the system, to then putting fences up in the countryside. But I mean, if everything's distributed, how am I going to protect it? How am I going to allow the openness of this technology to lead to threats? And if somebody can enter the network of sensors and change the bits of certain groups of data, for example, to switch on a switch or to reduce the light levels, for example, this could have an impact. So if we're talking about critical systems, this could be a real catastrophe, this could be disastrous, which would really threaten the environment, the economy, the people in that country. So we'd be coming back to the battle that I mentioned before, and this is really important when we're talking about critical infrastructures.
Besides, the threats profile has evolved through time, and the profile of attackers has changed. In prehistory, an attacker was someone who wanted to have notoriety, who wanted to show the or prove that he had a certain knowledge on a topic, and he just did an attack. That wasn't too evil. So as people saw that there's money in this, there are mafias involved, cyber terrorists, not just in the fact of money being involved, but the security of a country is at stake here. So nowadays, even the states put on the table cyber armies and people that have been recruited to attack SCADA systems of other countries. So we'll see about this with some examples next. There's just a piece of news here about something that was notorious until recently, but it wasn't public, which is that China, just like other countries, have made public and are not hiding the fact that they have cyber armies ready for cyber attacks and cyber defense. They are regularly trained and on constant alert. So just imagine the big danger this could cause for a critical infrastructure. In fact, if you allow me to focus on this type of threats, here we have a report that L Security, or Dell Security, issues every year, and there are many research studies of this type, but this one is especially focused on SCADA systems, and it's very interesting. What we see on this year's report is that the SCADA systems have been the object of constant threat, and in fact the number of attacks on this type of systems has doubled up. We went from 500,000 incidents registered in January last year, and if we compare it with the 2013 results, it was half of that. So what are the main targets or the main threat objects? Those more industrialized countries that have SCADA systems that are more connected in the lines of 4G, such as Finland, the UK, the USA. And obviously this is a massive problem, mainly due to that ability for connectivity and for having access to internet of the systems. If you allow me to zoom that pie chart that we have down there, we can see this, where nearly a fourth of the attacks of these kind of threats corresponds to buffer overflows. And the buffer overflow is still nowadays one of the most frequent threats in these kind of SCADA systems. We're not losing track either of the invalid inputs for these kind of systems, and all of that is due to the fact that in the first case there are no mechanisms to establish the end of memory that needs to be controlled, not to overflow. And in the second case, there are no mechanisms to validate the inputs of the system. Maybe they work functionally, but what happens, for example, if we do a bit of fuzzing and we enter values the system doesn't expect? Well, this renders problems. But without further ado on the rest of threats, because you probably all have them in mind, but I'd like to focus on another of the threats that we'll see next, which is information overexposure. Something that initially might be just like something really silly, saying, okay, this is my system is set up on the SCADA system, just that can lead an attacker by using social engineering techniques to determine the exact model, to identify vulnerabilities on it, and to exploit them through public exploits. So here we should also focus. At this point, one could wonder, okay, all this about 4G is great, but hold on there. I control my SCADA system, I have enough controls, and besides, they are secure because no one got into them ever. Mac, error. There are two types of SCADA systems, the ones that have been attacked and the ones that still don't know they've been attacked. At this point, I'd like to go over some of the incidental objectives or targets we've found through the history of SCADA. That means that we had an attack, but it was not specifically designed for a certain infrastructure. It may be a virus or a bug that one way or another, maybe due to a USB or email, got to a critical infrastructure, an attachment was opened, it got executed, and there's a big mess. One of the best known is in 2003, an incident at the nuclear power station of Davies Bessie, where there was a slammer bug that created denials of service that has slowed down the functioning of the network. It's not something hypercritical, but here we have an important incident of service denial in a nuclear service infrastructure. Careful here. And we have more examples, not to mention them all. In 2004, travelers, transport companies such as British Airways, Rail Corp, or Delta Airlines that were affected by the Sasser bug that provoked a buffer overflow and had a physical impact that was seen in train delays, flight delays, cancellations. So as you can see, the impact has an importance in the measure that these systems affect people. Again, denial of service on a public service, and also military. This is very critical. In 2009, with the Configure bug, we had a vulnerability on a Windows system, and it exploited the vulnerability that the administrator's password was not well kept, well custodied, and it was soon changed by default. So these kind of things showed failures when it came to downloading the flight plans of certain army infrastructures. And let's go to the most interesting part. Obviously here, if they want to attack you, they will. And these are the aimed attacks, or directed attacks. I target a certain critical infrastructure and I go for it. And if I have the proper resources to do so, that infrastructure, if it is not well protected, it will be under serious trouble. The most notorious case in 2010 was with the Saxnet. It was the incident and the attack that opened the eyes of many organizations and states when it comes to protecting their critical infrastructures. Just to give you a reminder on these type of attacks. It was a bug that reprogrammed the PLCs of industrial systems in nuclear power stations at Natanz, Iran, mainly the nuclear centrifuge. And what this bug did was exploiting 0 days vulnerabilities unknown until then for Windows. And here we're already in a conspiration stage. And given the load of hours to do such an attack, estimated by some analysts in about 10,000 man hours, these are large projects that are only at the reach of micro companies or some states. I will not mention which states focused on the Iran centrifuge, but I'm sure that some of you may think of some. And the impact was very clear. This attack killed a fifth of Iran's nuclear centrifuge. And when attack is directed or aimed or targeted and has the appropriate resources to exploit a vulnerability, that's how they do it. If the vulnerability has not been discovered, they will, because they have the means to do so. And with all the problems with 4G, just if this wasn't enough, our SCADA systems are even more defenseless. Our sensors and sensors networks are vulnerable to many sorts of attacks and failures, not just incidentally, such as a battery losing its charge or a hardware problem because it was faulty from the start, or because wireless communications are exposed to different interferences in the aerial environment or in the air environment. or even to different errors in configuration or deployment of the nodes. All of these may be an incidental or accidental cause of not really knowing how to do the deployment, but we also have attacks such as signal attenuation. I can have an attenuator or a dimmer. I can consider modification attacks of data contents if we talk about tampering. And as I was saying earlier, I get a bin, I modify it. Instead of turning it on, I turn it off. Instead of opening a valve, I close it, or the other way around, and this can have disastrous consequences. We can also have jellyfish attacks. I say I send the data, but instead of it getting at the appropriate time, I delay it. And this is critical when we talk about installations needing or requiring real-time requirements. If a data gets in 1 second, fair enough, it's good. If it gets there in 2 seconds, maybe you can consider it didn't get there. And that has consequences in distributed and industrial systems. Likewise, taking to the extreme, we're talking about black hole attacks here. The data end up in some sort of drain that is not going anywhere, and we can consider that the communication has been lost. However, from the network operator's point of view, we need to discover and try to identify whether that attack or that attack manifestation, which is a black hole, is accidental because the node failed and it doesn't route or reroute the data it should reroute, or whether it's malicious by someone who is trying to harm and do harm. So these are the threats that we're going to find in the SCADA 4th generation systems. And here we have a massive amount of threats, as you know. Therefore, in particular, regarding 4G and the 4G SCADA systems, we'll find the following challenges. On the one hand, the communication protocols, which are those used to reroute the information from a node to a gateway, to the final receiver of the information, are not designed to include security by default or by design. So far, most protocols have been used to have an acceptable behavior regarding the performance, but they didn't consider security by default. That's the first approach, or the first focus. Second, the traditional protection schemes stop being exclusively valid in this context. We could say, well, let's add a lot of cryptography, but it doesn't really work that way. We need to assume that in these kind of systems, networks are self-managed. We cannot consider the traditional infrastructure with public and private keyword, because that will entail a higher resource consumption. It will lead higher information delays. The packets are ciphered, they need to be reciphered, they need to be resent, and that leads to a delay, to an overhead. And please take into account that eventually the resources we have are scarce. We have little devices of this side and that are very good processing wise, they do what they can, but we cannot overload them with a big cryptographic layer, because eventually we'll lose the most important thing, which is their functioning. And finally, the limited batteries. We cannot consider that these type of systems will last forever. They may need to be replaced, or the battery or the node may need to be changed. And this leads to another problem, which is the keyword exchange. Or the keyword change. Shall we put the same password for everyone? Should it be a secret password? If we're talking about public-private infrastructures for PKI, then we have a problem with distribution. What do? Do we create distributed CEAs? Do we create a centralized one that all nodes go through? And all this is deployed on the field, so it's not trivial. So the question we wonder is, can we do better than we currently do? And obviously, in fact, yes, otherwise we wouldn't be giving this workshop now and telling you all about this. So what can we improve? We can improve when it comes to protecting our system at two levels, organizationally and technically. Obviously, the type of workshop we are currently attending leads us to focus on technical measures, and we'll talk about that in the second part of the presentation. But let's see the organizational measures we should take into account. First of all, cybersecurity awareness. It's essential, mainly when we talk about industrial environments. Right now, in industrial environments, unless in IT environments, they have been less permeable to cybersecurity. So if this system works well, I'm not going to touch it. That's the main principle. Including security layers, new mechanisms, updates. Let's see how we include that in the SCADA. Because the most important thing is availability, mainly. In industrial systems, is availability. So stopping the system, updating it, and all those things, we're less prone to doing them in industrial systems. So first of all, cybersecurity awareness. Secondly, we need to act at management level to improve the security policies. It's useless to have defined security policies if they're left in a drawer. No, we need to force their compliance. So this may seem trifle, but it does happen in most organizations that we audit. We see that policies do exist, but at the end of the day, the system cannot be touched because it's working well, and to a certain extent, the compliance with security measures adds a certain complexity. Then we have task separation. Also very important, the person who deals with the system development integration shouldn't be the same person who does the testing or the benchmark to see which configuration is best. So we should work jointly, but in an isolated way, each one working on their responsibility. So we should have external regular audits looking at the risk analysis. This is also very important. Everything that allows us to have a status or a picture of the security status of my system is an added advantage for me. Why? Because eventually, either the attacker has information or I have it. If I have it, it's better that I get there before the attacker, because if they're going to try to attack me, at least I should have the opportunity to have the appropriate limitations to delay the attack. Not to prevent it, because nowadays, if they want to go in, they will. But at least we could have chairs, tables, or some obstacles, or hindrances to get enough time to try to identify an intrusion attempt to deploy the appropriate mechanisms. With that, we could have at least an appropriate protection level. Technically, we'll talk about the introduction of security in the life cycle and exploitation and maintenance of systems. On the one hand, it will be essential to work now from point one on security requirements identification. This is what we call security by design. From the very beginning, we'll try to include security in the final system we'll be implementing, because otherwise we'll just have patches and we'll just try to keep improving security when the system has already been created. And eventually these will be costly to maintain and it will take time from us. So let's concentrate on security from the very beginning. When we talk about implementation and integration, the essential bit here is the test design. The system needs to be well tested when we talk about critical environments, and the tests in their different array, whether there are regression tests, to check whether the changes we're applying to new versions are compliant with the rest of the systems that are operating. We need to know how to manage all that. Also, stress tests. We need to put higher loads on the system than their baseline and their usual normal work. So with this, we'll realize how possible it is to force a system without creating a failure or without creating a control failure. So taking the system to a safe state. We'll also talk about the robustness tests. When we launch the tests, we'll test different entry combinations for the inputs. And we mentioned that earlier with the attacks. this will all lead to what I told you earlier. If the system fails, you will fail well in your controller state. And then we have intrusion tests, known as pen tests. And in the Extensa, we introduce cybersecurity in these systems. They have an important weight. We're trying to obtain that external view or internal view of someone who tries to do an intrusion on the system and the success they may have and how far they can get in. So that's what we'll mention in the last part of the presentation. We'll mainly focus on intrusion methodologies, which is what we'll map afterwards with the attack that Michele will present. So let me just sum up the points we'll find. There are many methodologies for testing or pen testing in the cybersecurity environment, even though I like talking about testing in general, because in fact the test should be considered comprehensively. Intrusion is very well, but everything we considered here is essential too. Robustness, stress, functionality. We should consider all that in a comprehensive way, and that's essential, because we could find that some systems are complying very well with certain security requirements, for example. That's great, no one can get in there, but functionally that's not working. So we need to consider everything as a whole. We do the tests considering the different sites that have been taken into account. So we have 7 points here, and we could consider different types of methodologies. The one we consider is this one. 7 points, and the first one is the definition of the TOE. The TOE is a target of evaluation. And this is not our own methodology. You can find it in international standards such as ITSEC, TESSEC, Common Criteria. These are notes on the standards that try to achieve the assessment and certification of software products, for example, or hardware products that need to comply with certain criteria. This is a TOE. And what is this about? Well, it's the information collection, the modeling of the system, the modeling of the threat, the implementation of the attack vector, the exploitation that will be that attack vector taken to practice, and finally the assessment of results and seeing what is happening with everything we've built. So the definition of the TOE is here. It leads us to define the system of the components whose security we want to assess. This may seem trifle, but it's very important. I'm going to assess the protocol, but how can I assess it? Is this protocol or the operation system on which the protocol runs, or the server on which the operative runs? We need to focus on the target we want to assess. This configuration we consider will lead us to establish certain failure and attack hypotheses throughout the pen testing cycle. So that's an essential point. Besides, we need to determine the value of the asset to be assessed. We cannot just say, well, I'm going to assess this because I think it's important. You may be right, but you should do a risk analysis to assess which is the most critical component. If that's the component you think is critical, but eventually the matrix of the risk analysis says it isn't, maybe you should focus on another most important one. So we always recommend doing an assessment of the target to be assessed.
Segundo punto, la recolección de la información.
Point, information collection. Here we'll identify a gradient perspective that takes us from a black box perspective, like I don't have any information that a hypothetical attacker, to white box tests, when I have more information to do the attack and to guide it better. On many occasions, not by doing a white box test will we prove better intrusion test capabilities. Very often, what may be given to a certain client is, well, will this take more or less time, but eventually I'll be able to profile your system. And if you really matter about having critical protection in your system, please give me certain information so that I can optimize the time. We can do it with a black box, but it will take longer. So it's just a trade-off, a commitment between or a compromise between what the customer wants and the critical assessment needs of the system. To collect that information, we can use different sources, from documentary sources until reverse engineering sources, and we'll see that next. We can be based, for example, if we talk about a standard protocol, we can be based on RFC and determine that a protocol's points and the flow of interactions being followed with inputs and outputs, or we can actually do reverse engineering that leads to using tools that will give us a knowledge that we didn't have previously on the target of evaluation. So we can use from topology discoverers, an Nmap, or even a sniffer such as TCP dump, Wireshark, if we talk about network or packages, and from here we can get packages and do assessment and do different types of analysis on the content. If it's a static component, we can go to the compilation and we can decompile and extract the behavioral flow of the component. There are different techniques here. We have focused on the first point, on the scanning tools, because this is what Mikel will tell you about later. But what are we going to look for here when we launch a TCP dump or a Wireshark? We're looking for traffic patterns that get repeated frequently to look at the impact that may have in the component we are assessing. So here there is a little capture showing the payload of what may be encapsulated within a TCP or UDP package with a hexadecimal sequence. So what is this about? Well, this is basically trying to collect all that information to give a name to all the questions we have there. There may be data fields there, and if the point of this stage is to collect all that information. In the next stage, the modeling stage, we'll try to give a name to those questions that we didn't have in the other stage. The aim is to understand the influence of inputs on the processing of the system's outputs in a system that allows feedback. So if we take the example of the payload that we had identified that has been transferred between a SCADA component and another SCADA component that may be done through a BusCon or an Ethernet network, token ring, any. In an industrial system, that entails trying to model and identify and launching a hypothesis for what we think corresponds to those fields. So here the hypothesis is that the first field corresponds to the node identificator and the second is a control message to turn on the node. The response that may come from the controller is, okay, I'm the node 2350 and my control message is okay. Launching that interaction hypothesis between the components is essential to launch our pen testing strategy. And eventually we'll go to what we see below, a status diagram where through different inputs we go to different outputs and there is an interaction between the components. The threat modeling allows us to, from the prior information we collected, allows us to think as if we were attackers and launch strategies and hypotheses for that pen testing. So I'm going to imagine this and see how it fails. In fact, that's the basis. And this is where we introduce the concept of failure hypothesis. So I'm going to imagine what happens if the field had this size. What happens if I exceed the node identification field with more bytes? Or maybe there will be an overflow affecting the second field. And what are the consequences of that? Is there a protocol ready to identify that overflow in the control field? Is there not? That's something I'm wondering about. The second hypothesis, what happens if I send commands that are not understood? Does the protocol identify syntax-wise that is correct or not? Does it prompt any warning? These are hypotheses that I'm just launching to the system, and the output of those hypotheses give me a certain knowledge that I write down and that I keep.
También podemos partir.
We could also talk about the semantics. So if we're trying to find, for example, if we have a replay attack, then I could repeat it. And apparently, I know that the syntax is correct, but what happens if certain fields are left blank? I mean, the syntax could be correct, but so in semantic terms, this would have an impact. And how would the protocol interpret that? And what happens if I send contradictory messages? For example, I'm identifying something from control with an activity or a capacity which will not let the control node participate. I mean, these are examples. I mean, I could talk about 50,000 more, but this is the basis for the concept of threat modeling. And what's interesting here is what? Well, if we look at small atomic kind of actions, the way we enrich all of this knowledge about the attack, we can bring in more complex actions and we can move on to more complex attacks. So what we're seeing here is just one little example of an attack tree, which is what we use when we look at threat modeling, and it allows us to kind of navigate or follow certain paths towards a target which we could have in the root of in the very roots of the tree in order to try to attack. So by means of different routes with different composition, we are trying to really exploit what we can find at the root of that tree. So if we have the implementation of the attack vector, so that hypothesis that we've developed, it's all about implementing it. In order to construct the attack vectors, we can use many existing tools, and we have a basis already which exists. And here we've got a screenshot which is for a tool which is for packet forging, and these are packets that do everything for us apart from the payload for TCP or UDP. And there we would have to add the intelligence that is necessary. We'd have to have scripts that would allow us to have the byte sequence in order to do a trial and error process. And how does this work in practice? Well, the objective is to execute this payload, the attack payload, and right now we talk about the attack load because we give it a malicious character. And so what's the objective? Well, we have to launch it and see what happens. What's most difficult is that we may see what happens on the left. So in other words, we would drop the bomb and it would, well, I mean, if we wanted to hit the target first time, you know, that never happens. Maybe only in some episodes of CSI, but in real life, it never happens. So what we move on to is the second picture, where we launch or carry out several attacks, several attempts. We do this in an automatic way with different configurations for the payload, and we see what happens. Or an alternative, what we could do is to recover as we carry out the attacks. We can look at the logs, the records of what's happening, and we can have a feedback within the cycle. So we start off with a concept which is practically unknown for the target, which could be the image of a concept of a spiral attack. So I have no idea about how the system works, but little by little I acquire knowledge and understanding, and I get closer and closer to the specific element of the protocol. And depending on the target, this may be easier or more difficult, and it may be more or less dynamic and more or less determining. This means that with the same execution of that payload, we're not always going to get the same outputs from the system, and that's the worst thing that can happen. And this comes back to the first point we talked about. This is the identification of the target. Well, if I was evaluating a protocol, yes, okay, but the protocol, if it's executed in an operating system, it has certain circumstances, conditions, hardware, and that's going to have an impact on the outputs that we get back. So we have to be very clear about the setup for the system. This is going to be really clear if we want to increase how much it's a determining factor. The greater the precision of the profile that we want to attack, then the more definitive the behavior of my attack or the results, and the outputs will be more or less similar. And if we finish with this, then just the bonus phase, always to do a reset of the system each time we carry out a pen testing campaign. Why? Well, because we could contaminate the system and And a second attack, a repeated attack, could be based on a non-original version of the system, so all of the results we got from that output would be biased. We wouldn't know whether we were evaluating the original system or the cousin system, which is the result. And so that has an impact on the final conclusion regarding the consistency of the system. So each campaign of pen testing should have a reset for restoring the system in order to make sure that all of our efforts are going in the same direction, are working in the same direction with this TOE, this TOE that we have defined at the start. And lastly, I would finish with an introduction to the methodology. And now what we're going to do is to have a practical case, which Mikkel is going to show us. He's going to show us how to apply this methodology of testing to a system which could perfectly well be a candidate for a fourth generation SCADA system. So Mikkel, I shall give you the floor. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. Well, I'm Mikkel Martinez. I'm a researcher in the UPV in the fault tolerance group, and there we work basically on evaluating the reliability of critical systems, and in this case SCADA systems. And more specifically, in my thesis I talk about rerouting protocols in ad hoc networks, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what we can see here. We've got this apparatus, these devices, and I'm going to explain what this is all about. Then what we're going to do is, following the methodology that Jesus has just explained, we are going to carry out an intrusion into an ad hoc system in order to understand the vulnerabilities and how we can exploit those kinds of systems. So we, in my research group, what we have is a platform for evaluation in which we evaluate different routing protocols, all of them for ad hoc networks, and we use nodes, which are, well, I imagine you'll be familiar with them. These are the Raspberry Pi type, and we have the latest model, the Pi Model 2 here, and through the network, in order to give them wireless connection, we use Raspbian. I think it was a Jesse distribution, which is the latest one, which is available through the official website. And this kind of components are very powerful because, besides being very economic, I mean, in total, between the what with the charger, the cable, we're talking about €70, and you can get a node which will give you ad hoc connection, and you can use GPS sensors, temperature sensors, humidity sensors, and you can connect them, and you can distribute them in a relatively simple way. So with less than €1,000, we have quite an interesting network. And what we've done is, in the university, we have 12 devices of this kind. We have them all interconnected with a central node, which is in charge of controlling the execution of the experiments. So we prepare experimental campaigns which allow us to try out different protocols regarding different vulnerabilities. For example, when the protocol is affected because in the network there's a lot of noise, there are problems with the communication, or, like we're going to see this afternoon, when we have a node which works as a malicious node. It goes into the network to falsify information, to forge information, or to acquire the information that's being sent through the data network. And in those cases, what we do is, through the cabled network, here you can see we have the different nodes all connected to the switch. It's a little bit, well, it looks a bit messy, but that's what happens when we do things live. And this is connected up with a computer. We're going to look at how we tell them what to do in each moment and how the protocol works, because we're going to simulate mobility. The ad hoc networks, in many cases, are networks are mobile. And so here we're talking about, or we have the chance to form topologies in a dynamic way. So if one of the nodes leaves the network or enters the network, we can establish routes in a ongoing way, but obviously we're not going to be moving things while we're doing an experiment. I mean, we could leave them for days doing experiments. So what we do is for the mobility is we emulate that. So we have the control network and the data network that we do the experiments, we get the information, and then we analyze the services provided by the service compared to the faults or the attacks that we've injected, and the data network in order to incorporate it within a real network. If we talk about mobility, if all of the nodes are connected in the same network, they can all see the other nodes, they're all visible between themselves. So here we have to consider the situation where one node is not within the reach of another node. And this means that now we're starting to work with BANETs. I don't know if you're familiar with them, but they are vehicle-to-vehicle networks. And the topology, the network topology, the communication between cars would be generated in a dynamic way, because you move in front of a car, for example, and you can have a communication between the two, but once you've gone past it, then that communication is lost. So that mobility, which means that the nodes can see each other, then they stop seeing each other, is something that we emulate. And how do we do that? Well, I'm going to show you here. I don't know whether you can see that very well. We had a few technical problems at the start before the presentation, and let's see, with the picture, let's see. Well, for example, we're going to talk, well, we have these knots. We have node 1, okay? And then we have node 4, the one that's just below it. So what I'm going to do, so node 1 is communicating with node 4, because right now they're next to each other. And then what we do is we apply rules in the communications, in the IP tables, in the Linux network to make them, or to block this communication between the two. Just one moment. So what we're indicating here is, sorry, I can't see that very well. Just one moment. Here we have it. Okay, so what we are saying is that all of the packets that come from a node with that address, they have to be discarded. And all of the packets that come from, that have that MAC, we're not going to reroute them. So right now, if we repeat the ping, we can see that the communication is established. Sorry. Okay. Because we were testing things earlier, we already had the protocol running. Hang on, let me see. I'm sorry. Well, this is what happens when we do things live. Okay. I forgot to switch off the protocol from earlier. Well, it means it works. That's right. Exactly, okay. Well, the protocol was already working. We'd started it before, so you could see it because they were rerouting through the central node. But, well, right now you can see. Now they're not communicating. Since they, well, node 1 is emitting or sending the packets, but when 4 responds, since it's been generated, then it discards them. So it's just like, it's as if, in practical terms, it's as if they didn't see each other. So we'll carry on. So what does this allow us to do? Well, it allows us to deal with different topologies. And here we're going to emulate a two-hop topology. So we have two of the devices which cannot see each other, so they would be the ones on the two extreme, you know, at the ends, but they have communication with the central node. And right now the nodes Well, the ones at each end can communicate with the central node, but they cannot communicate directly with the one at the other end because they don't know how to reroute that information. They do not know which routes the information has to follow in order to get from the left to the right node. And we have a fourth node, which is going to be the malicious node. This is what we're going to use to introduce ourselves into that network and get the information and route the information via us. And so we're going to follow the steps that Jesus talked about for pen testing methodology. So in the first of all, we're going to define the TOE, and here we're talking about the routing protocols. And these kinds of protocols, as Jesus has said, this allows us to establish the topology and the routing in a dynamic way. So if a node enters or leaves the network, this gives us the opportunity to establish new routes, new communications, and to always choose the best way to communicate our information from its point of from its starting point to its destination. We have different types of protocol. We have the proactive ones initially. We can talk about them. This is about sending information non-stop in such a way that it keeps all of the nodes updated in real time with regards to the topology of the network. So they say hello to each other, they communicate, they say, I've got this node next to me, I've got this one, I've got that one. So at the all the time they know the topology of the network and they know which routes are available for the routing of information. So when a node needs to send information of a specific nature, it knows where it has to send it. Then we have the reactive protocols, which work in a reverse way. They don't establish prior communication to establish routes, but rather when I need to send some information, that's when I look for the route. So that kind of protocol, what it does is it sends out some kind of probes, as we could call them, which go out and come back, and so they tell us about the route they've followed to get to their destination, and then the information is sent. And then we have a hybrid, which combines elements of both. And in this case, the demonstration we're going to do now, what we're going to use is the OLSR, Optimized Link State Routing Protocol. And this is used quite a lot in research for ad hoc networks. So since we have the target already defined, we're going to gather information about our network. And right now we know what the protocol is because obviously this has been prepared. We did that in advance. But often when we do experiments, we are not interested in knowing what protocol is running or it has been defined. We want the attacking node to discover it for itself. And for this reason, we need, well, as Jesus said quite rightly, we need to gather information with tools such as Wireshark, TCP DAM, or whatever we want in order to analyze the information. And that information can tell us about the protocol that's being used, for example, the OLSR, as we know. And since we have different kinds of protocols and different types, proactive, reactive, hybrid, we know what protocols are being used in order to find out the vulnerabilities exist in the system, because not all of the protocols have or suffer the same vulnerabilities. So that way we can find out how we can attack, above all if we know the protocols in advance. And after analyzing the traffic, we can also look at the network topology, because for example the proactive protocols exchange information all the time in order to know the topology that exists, and that would give us an overall view of the network that we are trying to evaluate. And then we can also determine the nodes that are within our reach, because if we have a very wide, large-scale deployment with lots of nodes, like the picture that we saw with Jesus, which was a very large area in the countryside with different nodes. Well, I mean, our nodes don't have scope to be able to cover them all, but if we, for example, in this case, here we have within our reach just three, but if the network continued, we wouldn't be able to cover them all. So the information allows us to determine the scope or the reach of our attack, into which nodes we can inject information, which ones we can have an impact on. Also, we can analyze the information that's being exchanged, whether it's sensitive information. It's not the same if we find out that it's information regarding customers compared to out in the countryside, and they're gathering information about humidity or the amount of sodium in the ground, in the soil. And then we have the analysis of information flows, which would allow, in this case, it would allow us to decide or define the victims of our injection. Because, well, why? For example, if we imagine we're analyzing the information, and we'll see this in a moment, and we gather, well, we've got two packets. One is going towards node, well, from 41 to 44, which was the ping that we were looking at earlier. And we can see that, well, through the headers of the IP and the Ethernet, we can see who is sending the packet and who has generated it originally. And that doesn't necessarily have to be the same. I mean, the one or where it was created, it was node 41, and the one that's going to receive it, the final destination of that or receiver of that packet would be node 44. However, we can see that the one that sent it, we can see the MAC, we can see it's node 41, but the one that's going to receive it is node 42. What that means is that when number 41, when it wants to resend information towards node 44, it knows that it is not within its reach and that information has to be sent via node 42. And in the same way, in the opposite direction, in this case, what we would detect is that when the information or the traffic goes in the opposite direction, the 44 sends information or the packets to number 42 in order to send them to 41. And so, well, we're going to see this a little bit with a network analysis so that you can see this. So what we've got here, what we're doing is we're launching the protocol, indicating the network card, which is the wireless one, and we're indicating that we don't want debugging. And so we can look at how it uses the rerouting tables in a dynamic way, but we're going to say no, because otherwise we're going to get a lot of information on the screen and it's not going to allow us to interact. So now we can see the routing tables. We can see them now. And we can see, well, let's see here. Well, we can't see it very well in this case. The routing tables for the different nodes, they're going to be updated as they exchange packets. And the way they can see each other, for example, now node 41, which would be the one on the left at the top, detects that node 44 has a hop. And with number 44, perhaps it's easier to see. We can see how number 44 knows that in order to reroute the information towards the destination node 41, it has to go via node 42. So those are the routing tables. That's what tells the node where the information has to be sent. So these packets, if we analyze them a little bit, if we analyze the traffic, then we're going to see what kind of information, like we said before, what kind of information is received and what the protocol is. So as you can see, here we have Wireshark, and many have been prepared to tell us what protocol it is and what information. So here we can see that the protocol is OLSR, and we can see the IPs for the nodes. And this gives us a lot of information about the protocol that we're using. And what's more, if we went into greater detail, we can see the kinds, well, we are going to see the kinds of messages that are being exchanged by this protocol. For example, here we have two kinds of messages. One would be the TC, and the other one would be the hello messages. And we can see that. Here we have a TC type message, and this would be a hello message. And I'll describe what they're all about in a moment. But as you can see, well, you just need to make sure you understand or take note of these two indicators. I'm sorry, I can only see the screen sideways on. It's a little bit difficult for me, but we've got the Hello LQ that we'll see in a moment. So what are these kinds of messages? These kinds of messages are, as I said, the TC and the Hello. Hello are messages, a kind of a greeting message, as their name suggests, which means that the nodes can kind of introduce themselves in the network and say, hi, I'm here. Let's see if there are any neighbors. Anybody near me? And so when a node receives hellos from other nodes, they know that they're within their reach, that they are their neighboring nodes. And those are messages, hello messages, are not resent. They are just sent to the ones within their reach, within their scope. And that allows the nodes to know what nodes are around them. And if we talk about topology control, what they do is they define their topology, the routes that they have. For example, the central node in this case would say, okay, my topology is that I have node 41 and 44 in sight, and I'm going to apply the link for those protocols. So 41, for example, knows that 42 has 44 as a neighbor, and that's what allows it to know that if it wants to get to number 44, it has to do it via number 42. Okay? And the link quality, well, I asked you to look at LQ and NLQ, because if we go to this, we can see that there is a basic definition of what routes to take. Well, here it's very clear because we only have three nodes and two hops. But when there are more involved, they have to decide what route according to the NFC. And they have to choose the one that has the least number of hops, the most direct route. And however, this has been shown that it's not always the most efficient. So there's an extension which is for the link quality. Because if I have Jesus within my reach with a direct link, the shortest route would be to send it straight to him. But maybe our link is very poor, and he may get one out of every seven packets that I send. But maybe I have a link with him, and everything I send to him arrives really well, and he has a connection with or link with Jesus, and everything he sends to Jesus arrives. So I've got more likelihood of my information getting to Jesus if I route it via somebody else, even though it's not so direct. So here, that's where we talk about the link quality. So that extension looks at the quality of the links through different hops, and that determines the best route, basing that on scores. And in order for you to see how that works, with the hello packets, they are sent by default every few seconds. And if we talk about the default functioning, it would be 2 seconds. And so according to the hellos received from the new neighbor, the node can know the likelihood of receiving packets from the neighbor. So if we said it's every 2 seconds, for example, I know that over 20 seconds from the first hello, I will have received 10 packets of that kind. If I get all 10, then I'm going to have a link quality of 100%. So there's 100% probability of receiving everything that my neighbor sends to me. But if I got half, then we'd be talking about a 50% quality. But what happens? Well, our neighbors do the same, and they determine the quality of the link that they have with us in exactly the same way. And we need to know the quality of the link towards us and also towards them. And for that, what we do is when we're exchanging the topology control packets, we know what neighbors we have with what topology. And when I might say to, with Jesus, Jesus, you're next to me, you're my neighbor, and the quality of the link with you is 100% because I've received all of your hellos. He already knows my link quality with him, so that's his neighbor link quality. And so with those two values, we can talk about the score that would establish the link quality. And when we have different hops than the scores, what we do is we add them together. So if we have 100%, the quality will be 1, and if it was 2 hops and the other was 100%, it would be 1 plus 1. And that's how it works. It's quite a simple formula, but this allows us to always choose the best route possible. And once we've modeled the system, What we're going to do is model the threat, so in other words, to think about what could be exploited, what vulnerabilities exist, so then we have the messages that are exchanged and the properties, the characteristics of those messages, and here that refers to the link quality. So what could we do? For example, we could, with those topology control packets that we've captured, and we're analyzing the signal, we could resend them after a certain amount of time. So we could see whether the topology of the network is affected by that, and perhaps that link that we're announcing that existed in the past no longer exists. In reality, it doesn't exist, but since they receive the packet, they may introduce it into their routing tables. So we interact each of the topologies, and we're leading to poor functioning of the network. And what this could tell us what would happen if we had fictitious links in the network, how long it would work correctly, how long it would take to realize that there are mechanisms that have been introduced, how long does it take for the network to adapt to those changes. And also we could announce false nodes, because not just resending packets that had been sent prior to that, but creating packets and announcing that there are neighbors that aren't actually really there, and links which don't actually exist. And in this way, the nodes will add those routes to their routing tables. And we have to take into account, for example, that here we're talking with the Raspberries, and we have the SD cards. I think we've got 16 gigabytes. So we're talking about nodes. We could say they're good. But often we're talking about sensors with or nodes which have very specific resources, limited resources. And in the past, we used to have routers with 16 megs for installing the operating system and the packets and exchange information. So what happened? Well, if we saturate the network with false links and the devices were to fill in their routing tables, then this would take up their memory. It would use memory, and this would mean that the nodes would be overflowing and they would stop working, and that would affect the functioning of the network.
And what we're going to do next in the Ngao demo is through the generation of these kind of messages, of false messages, we're going to indicate to the nodes at the end so their information and that the best route they can find to route it from one to another is through the malignant node, the fourth node we're talking about. These kind of attacks, I like to call it Mang in the middle, some other people call it sinkhole, because we're just being in the middle of a route, and that will allow us afterwards to manage all the traffic towards us, and that will open a wide array of possibilities regarding what we can do with that information. We can modify it, we can broadcast it later, discard it, fake it. We are talking about information that can be directed to the gateway, to the central control node, so we may be affecting the central system. And what we'll do is generate that kind of hello type packages and TCs. With the hello ones, we're gonna show our IP to announce ourselves as neighbors, but we're not gonna execute the protocol, we're just gonna regenerate them ourselves. And we're gonna tell nodes 41 and 44 that the quality of the links it is the best possible. And then we're gonna send the topology, the false topology control messages saying that we have them at reach, that our link with them is the best one, and we're going to tell them that their link with ours is the best one. We're going to send false information, and we're going to send it at a higher refreshers rate than the hellos are sent. So they're going to see that they keep receiving our messages, and they'll increase their link quality that they have with us. And when that link quantity in two leaps exceeds the one they have in central node, they'll reroute us, and they'll route that information through us. But here we need to take something into account, because earlier we assessed the network traffic to determine the victims of our attacks. In this case we have a third node, which is a central node, that could also see us. So if the hellos and the topology controls of these messages are sent in the same way as the protocol sends them in broadcast, they will be able to see them. But we don't want that node to realize we're there. So what we do, instead of rerouting that information directly to the end nodes, we send that information constantly until they see that their quality with us is better, and they add us to the route, and they reroute their information through us. And then we'll be able to false information or do whatever we want. So let's see it live. Let's see how it works. So right now, with these tables as the system is right now, you can see that the node 41 communicates to node 44 through node 42 on the top right side, and this one can see both of them. So when you do the ping from 1 to 4, that ping is just to get something visual. But usually we do this demo with a couple of monitors, video calls with the Giga. But the technical problems, you've seen the technical problems you had for the laptop, so we decided to do it this way. If you look at the TTL, most of them may know what it is, but just in case you don't, the time to leave shows that the node did an intermediate hop. It went through node 42.
Ahora lo que vamos a hacer es que nuestro nodo atacante
to do so, we'll see how they change and how they modify dynamically, how they modify the rerouting tables. This is a little program we have to generate those particular messages we're talking about. So we'll generate that kind of message stating that the malicious node, the one with the M, is node 43. We state our victims and the network interface that will send it through, and during how much time, in this case 300 seconds, which is 5 minutes. And with this, we're gonna help them change their routing tables. What we want though right now is that the information goes through us. To do so, we need to be able to resend it to the destination. So right now, if we look at the rerouting tables of the attacking side, they are flat. And the first thing we'll do before we do the attack, to establish the routes through us, and then the information will keep flowing and they don't notice anything. What we'll do, we'll add these routes. So before we begin with the attack, I'll have my victim nodes in my rerouting tables, so whenever they include me, that information will flow through me. And we need to enable the rerouting capability. Sometimes it is not enabled by default, and we need to indicate our device that all the information they get needs to be rerouted if it's not for himself. So right now we'll launch the attack, which is over here.
Vale. Vale, entonces, ahora mismo lo que estamos haciendo.
So right now we are resending that information to the nodes. As you may see, both nodes on the sides are starting to include us in the rerouting tables as a node with one hop. Can you see that? The main node, node 41, to get to node 44, has included us in its root, it has determined that our link is much better. So if now we did the ping, let's see here. Here it is. The ping is still in two hoops, but to check that we're really en route, we're going to disable the rerouting. By disabling the option to reroute the information, we see that the ping stops because they're resending it to us, through us, but we're blocking that information. We cannot let it go. We're not letting it go through. And if we enable it again, it is still there. So we've done a man in the middle, and from here we can do whatever we want with that information. It is being rerouted through us. He loves Mac. Well, what can we infer from this? We can infer and see that we've been able to exploit that vulnerability in the system. In particular, in the OLSRD protocol with the link quality extension. Besides, this kind of intrusion allows us to have other attacks. If that information flow is sensitive information, we can modify it, we can delay it, we can discard it directly. So what type of countermeasures can we make in this case for this particular protocol? There's a plugin for security, and even though the information keeps being clear, we can do a wild check and look at the information of the topology control and hello packages. They have an additional field that is an SHA key, a code. So when you launch the protocol, you indicate the password of your system. So since all the nodes have that password, they're all ciphered. So right now, if we don't know the password, we will not be considered a network of that network, a node of that network. But we need to take into account that if you are already a node in the network, you can get the information rerouted through you. So we need to take the attacker into account, whether it's external to network or internal. Someone internal may keep saying false packages and modifying the information. Or we could also establish distributed reputation mechanisms or watchdogs to allow us to assess the quality and the reputation of a particular node. So if a node is announced as good but none of us knows it, we're not going to consider it as the best node to reroute the information. So these are voting mechanisms so that the network itself determines which nodes are part and won the right to reroute the information. And we'll finish with this. Thank you very much for coming and for your attention. And we're actually hiring at Escasi. So if you're interested, let us know. And if you have any questions regarding what we've been talking about, let us know. It'll be a pleasure to answer. Thank you very much.
¿Hay alguna duda?
Any questions or comments? In fact, if anyone wants more information because you were interested in this deployment, please let us know and we'll be happy to talk about it with you. No questions? Then everything must be really clear. Either it's very clear or nobody understood anything. Thank you very much.